so that you can make some sense of what's happening, because it could seem as though there are several different activities happening all at the one time, it is important that I describe to you why we're doing what we're doing. Otherwise, what happens, you might have some difficulty in linking. May the 8th and the 12th is National English Week, a celebration of what our children do every day in classrooms as they learn language. And it's a celebration of many aspects of English teaching: stories, films, videos, writers, readers, performers, presenters, speakers, producers of written products, and so on. And here, we've been trying to capture the spirit of National English Week by having visiting authors, having a book cup, busking, film festival, and a badge festival. It's also National Arthritis Week, and Colin Tealy's book, Jodie's Journey, deals with this. And we have up behind Mr. Glass there a newspaper clipping about a Norwood footballer who is a very recent sufferer of this illness. And maybe you'd like to take the time later to read just what that means. We also have with us Gillian Rubenstein, and Gillian won the 1987 Children's Literature Peace Prize, sponsored by the Psychologists for the Prevention of War, for her novel Space Demons. And the balloons that are here are in fact balloons with peace messages, and after the procedures, they'll be released, and that they have to be released by, I think it's 12:45, so that we don't bring down passing jumbo jets. It's actually something to do with the air navigation situation. So, we will be linking in our time together the whole concept of National English Week, National Arthritis Week, peace, and we think that the new library that we have here is a focus for those activities. So welcome. And I'll now hand you over to Anthony Collins.
Today, our three school communities come together to celebrate the opening of our shared library. I would therefore like to extend a warm welcome to Colin Tealy, Gillian Rubenstein, invited guests, and all staff and students of Gleeson College, Golden Grove High School, and Padea Christian College. We have chosen to make this a special occasion because libraries are at the centre of our learning. They are places where we not only learn the skills necessary for applying information, but to use that information creatively. This is a unique secondary school library. While each school retains its individuality, this library offers all of us an opportunity to share our learning. Our closing gesture today is to be a plea for peace in the world. On a small scale, our library represents a desire to work together in peace and harmony. No matter what library you live, always at the heart you will find stories. Vincent will now introduce us to a creator of wonderful stories and poems.
It is an honour and a privilege to meet Colin Tealy and have him as our guest today. We have been brought up on his stories and know them so well. As a South Australian author, his settings are familiar, but his books have also been widely published and much loved in other countries. In 1977, he was honoured with a high national award, Companion of the Order of Australia, for his services to literature and education. It is because he writes in so many different styles, with such variations in emotion, from the humorous to the sad, that he captures our imagination as we grow from childhood to adulthood. As a formal introduction, we would like to read extracts from four of his books. To begin, Shay will read from the conclusion of Sun on the Stubble, where a country boy leaves his familiar surroundings for the uncertainties of a new boarding school.
The car topped the rise and seemed to pause before moving down the other side. A great wave of homesickness swept over Bruno and a lump rose in his throat. Deep within him, he knew that things would never be the same again. Something in his life was ending, something he loved as much as life itself. The car dipped down. The valley slid out of sight and was gone. Behind him, the sun hung round and gold above the slope. It was rising on a new world, Bruno turned to the front again and gazed blankly through the windscreen at the road ahead. He was coming down from the ridge above his valley, down, 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 from the sunny uplands of his boyhood with his great plans for adult life ahead.
Now Nick will read a descriptive section from Magpie Island, dealing with two birds in their element.
No doubt, Magpie would have gone on living, happily in his own right world, if it had not been for the eagle. He was a West child, a giant with a wingspan 2 meters wide. He came sailing out of another ball one day, like a huge, slow, dragon ship in the air. Perhaps he wanted a mate, perhaps a drought had driven him down to the far end, looking for food and water. At any rate, he cruised about in the high golden light as if he owned all heaven. He didn't flap his wings, he just stretched them out from his body like great sail planes, tilting and straightening, lifting and dipping, as if fingering the current of the wind. And in that way, they sent him sweeping through the sky in huge arcs, sometimes to the left, sometimes to the right, like a skater skimming on lakes of ice. He was so beautiful that some people could be watching him with tears in their eyes. He owned the sky, there was no doubt about that. Calm, serene, silence. He took in a whole kilometre in each tremendous sweep. You would have thought God was plotting his course for him with compass lines, an arc curving this way, an arc curving that way, the sky crisscross with half invisible circles.
A number of Mr. Tilley's books have been made into films by the South Australian Film Corporation. Many of us know Storm Boy, The Fire in the Stone, Bluefin as novels and films and videos. Mr. Wren will now read a segment from Bluefin in which Snook, Bo, Oki and Snitch are placing a huge tuna fish on the mayor's chair during a tunarama at Port Lincoln.
"Made it," cried Oki with a kind of hoarse triumph as they topped the last step. "Put him down for a sec, put him down." They were so weak that they all but dropped it. Then they sat panting and blowing beside the great fish, their heads drooping, their elbows on their knees, and their wrists hanging limply an inch from their eyes. "I stink like a skunk," said Bo at last, wrinkling his nose in disgust at his own hands. "A fish skunk." "Me too," Snitch agreed, "and all my clothes." He sniffed his sleeve. "Phew." "Never mind," said Oki phlegmatically. "If you stink, you stink." "Won't it muck up the mayor's chair?" Snook asked. "Not if we stand him on a cushion. They can wash that." Mention of the mayor's chair was enough to galvanise Oki. "Come on, chaps," he said cautiously, "in with him." "I'll open the door," Bo said, running forward. He turned the handle and stopped short. It was locked. Consternation, confusion, alarm. "What the devil do we do now?" Snitch asked helplessly. "It's not usually locked, is it?" "Maybe they've got it ready for the governor tonight." "That's it, I'll bet." "What about the mayor's parlour?" "Locked too." For a minute, the four of them stood leaning against the balustrade, looking disconsolately at the big fish lying at the head of the stairs. "Well," Snook said doggedly, "we've hauled him this flame and far. We have to do something with him." Bo's eyes brightened. "Aye," he said, full of inspiration. "Why don't we sit him on the throne?" "What throne?" "The one on the stage, for the tuna queen." Snitch's expression brightened too. Good idea, Bo. The beauty." Bo did one of his joyful canters around the fish. Then he stood up straight with his hand held high. "King Tuna, I salute you. We'll put a crown on his hector, you nong. A spectre's a ghost." "All right then, a scepter in his hands." "Fish hasn't got any hands, Dobie." "Well, against his chest then." "And a cigarette holder in his mouth. And an evening dress, that's what we need." "Hey." Snitch bent double with ecstasy at the thought. "Well, what about a pair of bras?" "Hot diggity." Bo did three more whoops around the fish, but Oki was much more matter of fact. "Where are you going to get these things from? You got them in your pants pocket, Bo?" "No, but there's a lot in the dressing room backstage, old clothes and stuff. I've seen it there." "Yeah, me too," Snitch said. "And how are you going to get him down to the throne across that flaming floor?" Snook asked. They were crestfallen again, but not for long. "I know," Bo said. "We'll pull him around the sides, hanging onto the chairs. It'll be a cinch."
pleased to say it's one of the books chosen for our book cup competition for all three schools. It's called Arthritis. Jodie's father stared in amazement. Arthritis? At her age? Dr. Klein nodded again. And I'm afraid it's rheumatoid arthritis, one of the worst forms. Jodie's father looked at him in bewilderment. But arthritis is for old people, surely? Dr. Klein shook his head. Not juvenile arthritis. It strikes people at all ages. Teenagers, children, toddlers, even babies. Believe me, I've seen them all. Jodie was still frightened. How did I get it? What causes it? He smiled wanly. If I knew that, I'd be the happiest person in the world. Don't you know? Nobody really knows. Not yet. Can't you cure it then? Maybe not cure, but we can help. We can help a lot. He filled out a form on his desk and handed it to Jodie. Take this form to the office at the end of the corridor, and they'll show you what to do. I want you to have some x-rays. When you've finished, you can join your father back in the waiting room. She wondered whether they were just trying to get rid of her. The two men watched her go out. I still can't believe it, Jodie's father said. Arthritis in a healthy young girl? It doesn't respect anyone, Mr. Carpenter. But she can be treated for it. Certainly, as I've said, we can do a lot for her. But not enough? Probably not enough. She could get worse? She could. Dr. Klein shuffled some papers and wrote some notes on a medical card. I want to see Jodie again next week, he said. By then we'll have all the results of the x-rays, blood tests and so on. Then we'll be able to work out the best treatment for her. In the meantime, I'll prescribe some tablets to try and ease the inflammation. Jodie's father left the office and walked slowly down to the waiting room. He felt that a dark shadow had suddenly blotted out the sunshine from Jodie's life and from his own. Ladies and gentlemen, students, would you please welcome Colin Teeley.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, friends and colleagues and students of the school. It's a wonderful thing to be meeting in a library. The library is a very special place. I suppose there are very few buildings in the world, other than perhaps cathedrals and churches, which command what a library commands in our lives. It's a precious place. And if you think that's a platitude, a cliche, then let me try to justify what I've just said. I emphasize those two words to make sure that you knew what they meant. Because in the first place, a library deals with words. And words are powerful and magnificent things. Believe me, they will affect your life, every day of your life, depending on what the words are and the order in which they're placed. Someday someone might say, "Will you marry me?" And believe me, although that's only four or five words, it's got an explosive effect. I'm not looking at Mrs. Teeley's eyes. And English, our main language, is very rich in words. Probably the richest language on the planet. Over 500,000, perhaps almost 750,000 words, of which in a lifetime we might accumulate, if you're very well educated at Golden Grove, as you will be, 20,000, 25,000, 30,000, out of 600,000. So we've got a long way to go. But the more we know, the more words we know, the richer our lives will have to be, especially in our choice of words and the way we handle them. The fine little nuances of meaning and feeling and association that words have, the little tentacles that they have, which can change our feelings, our emotions, our intellects. And English is rich because it keeps on pinching words from other languages. It is a predator. English, more than any other language, absorbs words like a great jellyfish. Holly. Some of them hundreds of years ago. Do you know that we took spinach, I have to consult my notes, we took spinach from ancient Persia 470 years ago? I wish they'd left it there first. But it is an ancient word, it's been with us a long time. Do you know that the word zero, which means empty, came to us from Arabic in 1604? What did you do in mathematics before then? You didn't have a zero. And some are very, very recent. If I may refer to that passage from Bluefin about putting a bra on the tuna fish, we lifted the bra from the French in 1923. That's very recent, isn't it? And we took snorkel from the German in 1939. And we took Sputnik from the Russians in 1957. And believe it or not, we took bikini from an atomic bomb test island in 1957. So the language grows, and a library grows with language and deals with language. It's full of books, increasingly so. And you say, well, what are books for? Well, it depends on your attitude. Some people, I'm told by a clever and witty person, go through a book. But other people prefer a book to go through them. I don't know which attitude you would take. And the oldest books are only just out, only just published, if you've never read them before, even though they go back to Roman times or Greek times. And that's another thing about libraries, they can transport us with enormous speed, instantaneously, to the top of Mount Everest, to the bottom of the deepest trench in the sea, to Antarctica, to outer space. You can have dinosaurs walking around on the shelves of the library. Just in a matter of an instant, by taking down the book from the shelf. So that's one of the beauties about libraries. They arrange something for every living human being, I do believe. The form of books may change. Well, of course, modern technology will probably see that it does. Maybe there won't be books as we know them in the future. Maybe they'll all be floppy disks or floppy something. But inherently, they will still work like books. They must, because they deal with words, with language. I don't know even whether the word library would be retained because it comes from the old Latin for book, libro. Maybe we'll change it to a different name. What would you have, a resource center? Would you change the name of a librarian to a resourcerist? Or a sorcerer? And a bookworm to a tapeworm? You wouldn't want to call a tapeworm, whatever you may have to be. Or a software addict. But whatever the terminology, that's immaterial. The essential fact is that a library deals with ideas, it deals with language, it enriches our lives. And that's why a library like this would be the heart of the school. Always will be. And I wish you well in it, and I open it with enormous pleasure, and I believe I'm to release a balloon to celebrate that occasion in a moment, and I hope I don't bring in a jumbo jet this time by doing that. Thank you very much.
Shiny shelves, between pages of knowledge, get jostled among the best from high school and college. In high-tech and computers, luxury of treasure, wilderness brother, great learning and pleasure.
There are novels and pictures, books covered by contact, of interest and boredom, of fiction and fact. Just stand by and chuckle at butterfly browsers, at pokers and prodders, in skirts and trousers. You pick up and put down, engrave indecision, you probe and examine with careful precision.
Each pausing and choosing must be my. Between this book and that book, he tires the sky. And then having tested all the things on display, decide that the first book was the best there that day. But then at the front desk, Mrs. Day will review past records and borrowings and books over too.
So here we all celebrate, and let's not forget, it's our Tilly Library, a great shared asset.
Officially opened at 12:30 on the 10th of May 1989.
Still got 5 minutes.